In the beginning of the Torah portion of Vayeitzei, Jacob has a dream. There's a ladder, angels are going up and down, and God speaks to him. God says the following: "Look, I am with you, and I will guard you wherever you go. I will bring you back to this land, for I will not abandon you." Now, Rabbi Isaac Luria, the 16th century Kabbalist, said something really quite alarming based on this verse. We know later on in the Torah portion that Jacob works 7 years for a wife. He wants to marry Rachel, and he gets duped by Laban, his father-in-law, and he ends up marrying Leah, and then he works another 7 years to marry Rachel. Rabbi Isaac Luria says this was an error on the part of Jacob, because God had told him, "I will not abandon you. Everything's going to be okay." So if you turn up in Laban's house and he wants you to work 7 years just to marry his daughter, you should tell him that's ridiculous. I'm not working 7 years. Either let me marry her or not. But to have to work 7 years just to have your daughter's hand in marriage, that's an unreasonable request. Why didn't he trust in God that God will find a way that he should marry his Basharat, his intended wife, without having to work 7 years for a wicked idolater who the Kabbalist said was an embodiment of the primordial serpent himself? You don't have to get that entangled in the forces of evil in order to get your work done in this world. It's simply not necessary. So Rabbi Isaac Luria says this was an error. And as we know, in Kabbalistic doctrine, all errors require reincarnation. To correct this mistake, Jacob was reincarnated into King David. And Laban was later reincarnated into Nabal, who features in Samuel 1, chapter 25, verse 16. We read that David is providing protection for Nabal's sheep. And why is that? Because in a previous life, Jacob had tended Laban's sheep in exchange for a wife. So to achieve tikkun, spiritual healing for this, the same process of guarding sheep had to be repeated in a future life. Now, I mentioned before that Laban was the embodiment of the primordial serpent. Not a particularly nice guy. Not someone you want to bump into. So if that's the case, it's kind of obvious question here. How comes that Rachel and Leah, who are the matriarchs of the Jewish people, buried in the cave of Machpelah, who are revered as our heroes till eternity, how could they have been born into a family when their father was nothing less than the essence of evil? How could such righteous people emerge from such a salubrious and unpleasant location? So, if you're a bit of a Kabbalist, you'll understand why. Because Klipah, the demonic forces, always try to inhibit and suppress Kedusha, the forces of holiness. And therefore, sometimes when very, very lofty souls come to this world, souls of holiness, the only way that the demonic forces will agree to this, if they are trapped and enmeshed in a very unfortunate and negative situation. And that is why Rachel and Leah were born into the house of Laban, the primordial serpent. And Jacob, who was a reincarnation of Adam, had to achieve tikkun, spiritual healing, for the sin of Adam. The sin of Adam was the mixing of good and evil. Now good and evil are mixed, so you can have righteous souls like Rachel and Leah being born to people like Laban. So along comes Jacob to correct that. His mission in life was to rescue these two precious souls, which had become mixed up with the demonic forces due to the sin of tree of knowledge, and thereby correcting the original mistake of Adam, who mixed the forces in the first place. So that is why Jacob comes on this mission to redeem these souls from the hands of Laban, which takes quite a long time, a whole parsha, a whole Torah portion. Now, as you know, Jacob wanted to marry Rachel, and Laban switches his two daughters and gives Jacob Leah in marriage. Jacob doesn't realize till the next morning when he wakes up and says, "Hey, this is Leah." Everyone knows the story, right? So the Zohar says something remarkable on this, and it is that it's a very fundamental teaching in Judaism, that when a man is intimate with his wife, he should not be thinking about another woman. And it turns out that's exactly what Jacob was doing on his wedding night. He thought that he'd just married Rachel. He didn't find out it was Leah till the next morning. So when he was intimate with Leah that night, he was actually thinking about another woman. He was thinking about Rachel. So how could that be? How could our patriarch have done something even unwittingly inappropriate, being such a righteous soul? And what were the results of it? So the Kabbalists explain like this, that as a result of this wrong intention of thinking of another woman, there was some sort of blemish in the child that was conceived. That night Reuben was conceived, and what was the blemish there? So later on we read this story, how Reuben moved his father's bed. He messed around with the relationship between Jacob and his wives, which was considered to be a very grave error. And as a result of that, Jacob was angered, and he said to Reuben that, you know, you're not going to be considered the firstborn anymore. Joseph is going to be considered the firstborn. And in that act, we see the original misintention of Jacob corrected. He thought he was conceiving Joseph that night. He wanted Joseph to be the firstborn, and the will of this tzaddik, of this righteous man, was ultimately fulfilled, and Joseph became the firstborn. And we see the divine providence, that the cause of the firstborn status being transferred from Reuben to Joseph was the blemish in Reuben's soul caused by the act of that night. So it's a very tight circle of cause and effect. Another similar event, which is less known, is that in chapter 30, verse 9, we read that Leah took her maid Zilpah and gave her to Jacob for a wife. Now, they'd already discussed that Jacob should take Bilhah for a wife, but there was no discussion of, which was, of course, Rachel's maid, but there was no discussion of taking Zilpah. So based on that, Rabbi Isaac Luria and other writers argue that Jacob didn't actually know he was with Zilpah. He thought he was with Bilhah, and again, he had this wrong intention during the intimate moment with his wife. And that is why when God was conceived, he was actually conceived with this wrong intention. The subsequent child with Zilpah was Asher. And Asher, by that time, Jacob already knew that he was with Zilpah. And Asher in Hebrew, Aleph Shin Resh, can be respelled. It's an anagram of the word Rosh, Resh Aleph Shin, which means head, in other words, consciousness, to imply that with the second child of Zilpah, Jacob was conscious of who his marital partner was, unlike the first time when he didn't know, he thought it was Bilhah. Spiritual message for this week. This is the Torah portion of Vayeitzei, which means going out. Jacob went out. He left the comfortable environment of his parents, which was an environment of kedusha, of holiness. He went to live with a wicked Laban. He went to work every day. He went out into the world. The profound message of this week's Torah portion is therefore that Jews in general need to go out. We've got to end this Jewish insularity, this ghettoism, this idea that Judaism can only be practiced amongst ourselves, and when we go out, either we don't talk about Judaism, we hush it up, or we just jettison it because it's irrelevant to the wider world. It's so crucial that Jewish values, Jewish teachings, Jewish pride be carried forth into the world. But how many Jewish, openly Jewish senators are there? How many openly Jewish congressmen are there that are proud of their Jewish heritage and proud of the Torah traditions? Not many. Because somehow we have trouble with Vayeitzei, we have trouble with going out. But you know what? Anti-Semitism can, I mean, we don't know all the causes for it, but it can often be healed by exposure. A lot of people hate Jews because they just never met any Jews, they never spent any time with any Jews. But I know myself, being a religious Jew, often I spend some time with non-Jews, and they tell me that, you know, you've changed the way I look upon religious Jews. You're not that bad. Exposure is so important for Jews, and that is the message of Vayeitzei. Are you in any way insular in your Judaism? Do you keep it to yourself when you go out? Think about it. It's time for more Vayeitzei. We really need this stuff. Okay, thank you very much, and listen again next week, God willing, to Torah Intact.